Our third and last speaker this morning is Laura Van Tveer, who is in fact the chief of clinical medicine and geneticist, head of molecular pathology in the Department of Pathology at the Netherlands Cancer Center. Laura did her undergraduate work at the University of Amsterdam and then proceeded to get a PhD at the University in Leiden, working with Alex Van Dab. She then moved to the Massachusetts General Hospital Cancer Center, where she was a postdoctoral fellow with Renee Bernards. Then she moved back to the Netherlands Cancer Center, where she is now. And Laura has really been responsible for pioneering the use of whole new approaches in understanding the transcriptional patterns in breast cancers and other cancers, and the use of that information in the diagnosis and outcome predictions in cancer. It's a pleasure to welcome Laura Van Tveer. Laura.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure for me to be here to contribute to your governor's symposium today. I think my talk will switch gears a little bit because I'm not going to talk about prevention of cancer, but more focused on prevention of recurrence of cancer. So I work at the Netherlands Cancer Institute, which is a dedicated cancer hospital and research institute where 1,800 people work, half of them in research, half of them in the clinic. And I have a second affiliation with Agenia, which is a molecular profiling company, which was a spin-off company from the Netherlands Cancer Institute. So 30 years of progress in cancer research, I think I started as an undergraduate student and was very fortunate that in the early 80s, I was working on one gene that we thought would be important for carcinogenesis. I think it's still around. But that in 25, 30 years, we now are able to look at a full picture, or as far as we can, of a cancer cell and know all the networks that are involved in the cancerous growth. And you can also look at it in a way that you like at an underground, that people know at which position they are, where to take the underground and where they want to go, and that it interacts with other trains and in that fact necessarily not to hit them. But in cancer cells, of course, these networks interact and together integrate into how a cell behaves. So I think in spite of all this progress that we're still very much depending on the light microscope for looking at cancer, and also we're using many cytotoxic drugs to treat cancer, but the genomic technologies are now starting to help us to improve more precise diagnosis of cancer. And also new therapies have evolved in the past years that are targeted to specific alterations in cancer cells. The microscope has been around for 350 years, and I'll show you this picture because the hospital part of my institute is named the Van Leeuwenhoek Hospital, so we're very proud of this microscope. And in 350 years, it of course have evolved in something which is more automated, and you can look at many more details, but even Van Leeuwenhoek 350 years ago was able to identify bacteria and other small organisms. So when we look at breast cancer, I think we are not only looking at the cancer cells that are here called invasive ductal carcinoma because the way how they look like is described, but also the integration with the lymph angiogenesis and the blood vessels that surround the tumor are taken into account. And so in my talk, when I discuss breast cancer, I actually discuss the integrative analysis of both the tumor cells and the surrounding normal cells. With now the way of the new genomics, I think we can improve by looking at these tumor cells and their surrounding normal cells by the use of microarrays. And for those of you who have never seen any, I'll shortly will give you two slides to get you up to speed how this works. So what this actually does is that when for a long time we were only in experiments, we were able to look at one single gene. I think the microarrays allows us to look at the comprehensive set of genes that are active in a tumor. So here you can see two Andy Warhol pictures where the same yellow dot is present, but the context is totally different. So you either see Marilyn Monroe or you see a nice flower bed. And of course, it's important to know at which one you're actually looking, and that is what microarrays looking at active genes can help you to do. So our focus of our research had been breast cancer, especially survival of breast cancer, and to predict who has a good outcome and who has a poor outcome in, first of all, premenopausal breast cancer patients that are diagnosed with lymph node negative disease. So from many meta-analyses, which is I'll show you here, it is known that 10 years after diagnosis, 70% of patients will have survived if they're only treated by surgery and local radiotherapy, and 30% will have died of their breast cancer. And of course, it's important to know who are those 30%, because those you would like to treat with further treatment, like hormonal therapy and chemotherapy, to prevent the death by breast cancer. And secondly, not only that we would like to identify those patients, but you would only also would like to know what is the best treatment we can think of so that they survive their breast cancer. Of course, there are at present already guidelines in clinical management. I'm just listing you two of them here, and I will come back later in my talk even to more. But the NIH some years ago said that women who have a tumor with a diameter larger than 1 centimeter at diagnosis are considered to be at high risk of recurrence. And so those are eligible for adjuvant, which is systemic treatment, which is the chemotherapy and hormonal therapy. In Europe, it's a little complicated, but they integrate age of a patient's diameter of the tumor, whether it's very many dividing cells, yes or no, and it comes to a group of over 80% of these patients that I just showed you who would be eligible for the chemo and hormonal therapy. But I showed you that only a smaller proportion of these patients will develop a recurrence at a distant site of their disease. And so many of these patients, if you would follow the guidelines I've presented to you here on this slide, would be so-called overtreated. And even some are undertreated if you only would look, for instance, at diameter. That it's really important to know which patients would benefit from therapy and what is the best likelihood how to predict that, is that if you look at this particular scheme here, so on the top you can see a particular patient that by a estimate will have a 54% chance of being alive after diagnosis and 36% of having a chance of having died of breast cancer and 10% of other causes. If for this particular patient, 10 years after the diagnosis, she would have received either hormonal or chemo or the combination therapy, you can see here the numbers of patients that would have benefited from that treatment. So you would rather know that you are such a 9 or 2 or here 11 patients that receive such a treatment to be really sure that you give the most optimal treatment. And for instance, everybody knows that chemotherapy has many side effects, so if it would not have any benefit, you will better foresee the treatment. That is really very problematic to decide, and it's usually discussion between the physician and the patient, of course, based also on these guidelines that I mentioned before, that if you look at this particular patient, which has what we call T1, but it means that the diameter of the tumor is rather small, there are no lymph nodes involved, and there are sort of a medium number of dividing cells, then it's known that you need to treat 100 women with chemotherapy for the benefit of just one. So that's at the edge of where people start to think, well, is this really beneficial that all of these women will have here, for instance, severe side effects for the benefit of one, and will I be the patient that will take this risk? I think that's different for every woman, and it's, I think, also her decision to take, but this is something we would like to try to improve. That it's really not that easy to recommend future therapy is seen here on a survey that was done by Martine Picard, a medical oncologist from Brussels, that was presented at the ESCO meeting a few years ago in the US, where she had sent this particular diagnosis of a patient to 40 experts worldwide. And what they had given her back, how they would treat after surgery and local radiotherapy, how would they further treat this woman? And you can see here that there is not that much consensus. So 50% would give no further treatment, 50% would, but then they would give all different schemes of treatment. So there is room to improve this, and maybe genomics can help us here. And that's what we asked ourselves. Can we use now the activity of genes to help us to better determine who is at risk for a recurrence and who would benefit from what therapy? So in two slides, I promise you to show what microarrays are, if in case you've never seen them. This is just one type. What you see here is a glass slide that contains all these droplets. Every droplet contains one representative of a gene, and we now know that there are approximately 30,000 genes in the human genome. So you have to imagine that there are 30,000 droplets here, each representing one of these genes. One takes active genes from a tumor here in red, which is described in RNA. You put there a fluorescent dye to that particular active gene, and each gene will find its counterpart on the microarray. We compare it to a reference, which is, for instance, normal tissue, and you can see that some genes are very active in the tumor, others are totally absent, because then you only see the reference, and yellow means they're equally expressed. So what one then does, so this is how it looks in reality, so here there are 25,000 of these little droplets seen. These are scanned, and the intensity of each of these is measured. And then comes in bioinformatics, where you would like to identify a pattern that is related, for instance, with a recurrence of disease or no recurrence of disease. And so I've been working with many physicists and bioinformaticians to try to identify patterns in these. So this here you see one tumor where all genes are expressed, but if you do a whole series, you can start recognizing patterns. So what we did by doing different bioinformatics techniques, we came up with a set of 70 genes that are significantly associated with recurrence of disease. And that you can see here on the right. So with the white bar is indicated a woman that after her primary diagnosis developed a metastasis. So what we did here, we took tumor tissue from women who were diagnosed in the past between 1983 and 1995. That was banked in our frozen tumor bank. We isolated the active genes and we put them on a microarray. We also knew the follow-up of all these patients, so we did know whether they had developed a metastasis, yes or no. We also selected those patients that they, at that time, had not received any chemotherapy or hormonal therapy, because at that period in time, that was also not the standard. So what you're looking at here is the true biology of those tumors and their outcome of disease. And you can see here that these 70 significant prognosis genes, when ranked in this order, so every column is a gene and every row here is a tumor, gives you a pattern here on the top that's quite homogeneous, which is related to a low risk of a metastasis, which we call the good signature, and the bottom, which is related to a high risk of a recurrence, which we called a poor signature. So what we subsequently did when we are analyzing new tumors, we isolate the active genes, we label them with this fluorescent dye, and we compare whether the expression of the 70 genes of such a tumor is related to either this top pattern or the bottom pattern, and we describe them as having a good signature or a poor signature, being a low or high risk for recurrence of disease. You can understand that the threshold between the two groups can be put anywhere, so you could also put it higher up, but we decided to put it here and that we would allow to have 10% false negatives in our system. But would be welcome to discuss that later if there are any questions on that. So when we took a following series of patients that were treated in our hospital also before 1995 and we distinguished their tumor profile into the good signature or the poor signature and correlated that with their outcome of disease, you can see that 40% had a good profile and very excellent prognosis, so this is survival, and this is being free of a distant metastasis, And the poor profile had a much worse survival as well as a high risk for metastasis by breast cancer. We then compared, for instance, this profile with the criteria that I described you before that were once postulated by NIH, which was only looking at diameter of the tumor. So here you can see that both the prediction of outcome of disease is better by profile than by this diameter, but also that in the NIH high-risk group, there may be a considerable number of patients that is actually at low risk. And why do I say so? Because at NIH, 90% of patients are identified as having high risk, whereas in the profile, this is only 60%. And by reducing the number of patients here, we're not jeopardizing their outcome prediction, because they actually have a very good outcome. So in other ways, when the 70-gene profile, which we have now called MammaPrint, identifies 60% of these patients as high risk, NIH 90%, actually, if you would use such a profile, that would reduce the number of patients eligible for chemotherapy and would also improve their prognosis prediction. But this is, of course, one of the first studies we did. If you look at the very small tumors in that same series, and here I've selected tumors that have a diameter smaller than 15 millimeter, the interesting thing is that already in very small tumors, you can find the 60% of patients that actually have a tumor that has a high-risk signature, and so actually in the NIH low risk, if you only look at diameter, there may be a considerable number of patients that actually have a high risk for recurrence and that are currently undertreated. We then went on and actually decided with the Netherlands Cancer Institute to start the spin-off company Agendia to make this test available to more patients and also get it into a quality controlled level. So in the past 5 years within that company, we did several new studies, and we also achieved many of the regulatory requirements, including FDA approval, to use this test for patients in daily practice. So one of the first studies we did, and this we started in 2004, was actually sponsored by the Dutch Health Insurance Council, which is a government body in between the government and the private health insurance companies in the Netherlands. And so this Health Insurance Council regulates which tests or which drugs or which procedures in the hospital should be reimbursed. And they were immediately very interested in this new technology, and they wanted to see whether this can be implemented in daily practice and whether this is really cost effective. And for that, they gave us a grant to study this for 3 years in 20 Dutch hospitals. So in very short, in these 20 hospitals, up to 700 patients were asked to participate. A small part of the tumor was set aside where we isolated the active genes, put them on a microarray, and compared the pattern to this previously established good signature or high signature. And in some 450 patients where we actually were able to do this test, 50% had a low and 50% had a high risk. And so we're currently evaluating the cost effectiveness and the implementation of this test in those hospitals in the Netherlands. We also went on in a large European consortium called the TransBIC, which is a part of a breast clinical trial group called BIG, Breast International Group, to further validate this profile in European patients. So we first did a retrospective study, which is now followed by a prospective clinical trial. So this independent validation that we did included patients from 5 European hospitals that were also diagnosed with breast cancer in the past. They were from the United Kingdom, from France, and from Sweden, and they had similar characteristics for being eligible for this study, including that they were only treated by surgery and local radiotherapy and had not received any systemic chemotherapy or hormonal therapy. So in 302 patients, I show you the survival curves of those patients when we had categorized them in having a low risk or a high risk profile. And you can see that the 10-year overall survival prediction, especially of the good group, is very good, and that it's much better than the high risk profile group. We then compared the efficiency of predicting outcome of disease to actually a newer system that does that based on clinical parameters, which is, I think, widely used in the United States, which is called Adjuvant Online. So this is a web-based program which has been set up and validated by Peter Revdin, where you can put in for each patient different characteristics like age, whether there are any other factors that could relate to risk of death, like a heart disease condition, and also the diameter of the tumor, etc. So we put all the characteristics of the European series into this system and defined a threshold for low risk and high risk as being around 90%. It had to be at least 88 or 92% depending on the estrogen receptor status, and then we would call this low risk. So when we did so, the 70 genes, as I showed you before, identified 63% of the patients as high risk, the Adjuvant Online system 74. So again, what we see here, there is a reduction in the number of patients identified as high risk. But more importantly, 35% of the patients are in a discordant risk category. And actually, that's not only seen when we compare this to this Adjuvant Online system, but also to other clinical risk assessment parameters. So there are these 35% discordant patients, and the question now, of course, is who does a better prediction? So here, if we compare the disease-free, the metastasis-free survival of these patients, when we compare the 70 genes activity to this adjuvant, you can see here that these curves are more widely separated by the 70 gene profile than by the Adjuvant Online. So this led to the discussion that these discordant cases are better predicted by the 70 gene prognosis profile. We then went on, and this was actually the starting point, to really start a large prospective clinical trial, because all the data that I showed you so far were on patients that were diagnosed in the past and of whom we knew the follow-up. And for many patients and many physicians, I think such a test is only really valuable when you have addressed the same question in a prospective trial, although I'll come back with some maybe remark on that. So we started the so-called MINDACT trial, and MINDACT stands for microarray for node-negative disease may avoid chemotherapy. And this is now a European trial led by the EORTC breast group, where the aim is to see that genomics is better telling us which cancers will come back, and by implementing such a genomic tool, you can reduce toxicity, reduce cost, and reduce burden on the healthcare system. So in very short, this is the outline of the clinical trial. It has started last February, where some 6,000 patients diagnosed with breast cancer before age 70 with node-negative disease and for whom a little piece of the tumor is available for the gene expression array, the clinical risk will be assessed by both this system that I just showed you as well as by the 70 gene expression profile. And there will be, of course, concordant cases where both systems will say this is high risk or low risk, but we anticipate that 35% will have a discordant risk estimate, and then the decision making for further treatment will be randomized and will be either based on the clinical risk or the 70 gene profile. And the trial is powered in such a way, and the assumptions are that by doing it in this way, we will not jeopardize the survival of breast cancer patients in this particular group, but we will reduce the number of adjuvant chemotherapy. To switch gears a little bit, because for the other trial I just showed you, we had to wait another 3 to 4 years before we have the first results, I'll show you some additional data. Of course, there are all, in the meantime, other profiles published that can also predict outcome of disease. And many people got very worried because there are actually hardly any genes that overlap. I think if you have more a mathematical or physics background, you can maybe more easily understand, because if you would use different algorithms, you're bound to find a different set of genes if you are able to look at the 30,000 expressed genes for instance, 100 or 200 patient samples. So we actually set out to see whether if we would take the same group of patients, whether these different profiles would categorize them as good or poor prognosis based on either of these different gene signatures, and whether they would do that in a concordant way. So are these profiles pointing us to that there are many different breast cancers, or actually are they all pointing to the same fact? So one of the most famous ones, I think, is the molecular portrait as published by Chuck Peru and Teresa Surley in 2000, where they took a series of breast cancers and they did a different way of data analysis and postulated that there are five different types of breast cancers listed here. And they also, since these were also patients who were diagnosed in the past, looked at the survival of these patients based on the different subgroups. And as you can see here, especially this luminal subtype has a very excellent prognosis, as there is a 90% probability to be alive of breast cancer after diagnosis, which is up to 10 years over here. And if you have a basal-like breast cancer, your chances are much poorer. So this is one of the genes signatures that we compared with. Two other ones are one from our colleagues in Rotterdam, who developed in a very similar way as we did it, a profile consisting of 76 genes. And you can see here that based on their data, it does almost the same as we had published earlier. Also in the US, you may be familiar with the test Oncotype DX, which is marketed by a company called Genomic Health. This uses a set of 16 genes and 5 control genes to in breast cancer patients that are ER positive, so it's a bit limited patient population. They can nicely divide them in 3 different groups, and risk estimates of recurrence are given based on the Oncotype DX test. So all improve prognosis prediction. The Oncotype DX, as well as our 70 genes, are available for patients. This is just a research finding and not yet available as a diagnostic test. So the first comparison did that we took exactly the same RNA, so the active genes, from patients from these European validation studies and applied those to the 76 genes from the Rotterdam profile. And if you may remember some of my previous slides, you can see that there is, again, an excellent survival of those patients that are predicted to have a low-risk profile and are much poorer for the ones that have a high-risk profile, which is very comparable for what we had found for the 70 genes. We did a different type of comparison, and you don't have to look at the details, but here are different profiles listed. Here is the Oncotype DX test, here's the 70 genes, and you can see that all are able to identify a group with an excellent prognosis, so where the curve is pretty high and others are much lower. So we saw that there is actually an 80% concordance in assignment of high risk and low risk by each of these different gene signatures. But if you're interested to really identify a low-risk group, for instance, you want to find a test where this top curve is as high as possible and identifies as accurate as possible. So there's 80% concordance. They all give improved prognosis prediction, but some are better suited for clinical management than others. But I think over time, when we have done more and more of these experiments, I think there will be an improvement of either one of these profiles. I showed you this curve before for prognosis prediction, and although we can identify very well a group with an excellent prognosis here, it's still a 50-50 chance. So are there actually more molecular subtypes that are obscured by our 70 genes if we only look at the expression of them to predict high risk? So we took a little different approach. We took the microscope again, actually by one of our pathologists in the institute, and we looked at the morphology, histology of these tumors. So most tumors actually 80% of breast cancers are invasive ductal carcinoma, and those are cancer cells that are invading the surrounding tissue but still have some sort of a tube as their original morphology. And they are defined as a cancer that is not otherwise classified. And if you look here, you can see that if you are invasive ductal carcinomas here, that they can actually look very differently through the microscope. That has been observed before, because if you look at the WHO book of breast cancers, there are actually 30 different morphologic types of cancer. And that's based on different growth patterns when you look through the microscope. It's also known, and they are listed here, that some of them really have a very excellent prognosis. So although they are pretty rare, between 1 and 10%, they can have a very good prognosis and maybe very important to very well recognize them. So this is just how they look like. You can see that they look very different through the microscope, each differently. And they also look different from this invasive ductal that I showed you before. This one, for instance, has very characteristic bone type of cells within the tumor. So what we did, we looked at the gene expression pattern of these tumors that is shown here, and you can more easily see it here. And we did a bioinformatics analysis that is called hierarchical clustering. And what you can see here, that each histological type is color-coded, that some are really very nicely lining up together. We did observe, as is well known, that you have ER-positive and negative tumors, but within those you can see that, for instance, these lobular and tubular are very much alike, but the blue ones here, the micropapillary, have a very distinct expression profile. So that could be a different molecular subtype. So some are really very related, but some are also very distinct. We looked at one specific subtype, and if you are working in this field, you may be very interested in this basal subtype, as I told you that they are known to be very aggressive tumors. But we identified actually two histological subtypes, adenoacystic and medullary, when we compared it to the genes that distinguish between these molecular subgroups that would fall in the same category. And as I showed you before, that these have very good prognosis if pathologists, because there is not a real clinical reason yet, fail to identify this particular subtype of histology within tumors that is otherwise maybe recognized as basal in very many different ways, how that can be done, then you may miss subtypes that have very an excellent prognosis, although you think you're looking at a group that has a very poor prognosis. So what we're doing right now, we're using this molecular histological special type classification to see whether that can help us to really shed light on differences in the invasive ductal carcinoma that we had been working for so far. So will that help us if we use these particular profiles to really distinguish subgroups in this poor profile group that actually has a better prognosis than we thought of? And that if you now think you have a basal type that has a very poor prognosis, maybe there is a subgroup in there that actually have a very excellent prognosis. And if you have one that has an excellent prognosis, maybe we have indications that are even in there a type that has a more favorable prognosis than even luminal. So that may be a little bit confusing for you, but I think that by looking at the pattern of expression, we may be able to distinguish different types of breast cancer that can help us to really refine the prediction of recurrence of disease. So I have a few slides that I'll end up with, because I said besides it, we'd like to know the prognosis of a patient, we'd also like to know how to treat the patient. So for instance, if you look at the molecular subtypes, and some are known by other tests, they have particular genes that would help them to be eligible for specific targeted therapy like Herceptin. I discussed before the basals that are maybe beneficial treated by more aggressive chemotherapy, but I think you would really like to find a therapy response profile. So my last slides will deal with a profile that we have been validating of 81 genes that can predict the response to hormonal therapy. So which hormonal therapy is best? I think there are choices now for hormonal therapy, either tamoxifen or aromatase inhibitors, and we would like to have a test to know upfront which patient would benefit from which one of these therapies. So what we did is that we took the expression profiles of primary tumors and we looked at the response of patients who received tamoxifen for metastatic disease. And as you can see here, it can very well predict non-responders and responders in a training, and especially also the non-responders in the validation series. So if you would use such a profile up front, you could predict a 11-month difference in response to therapy based to tamoxifen based on this profile. So maybe these patients are better suited to have a different therapy up front. So we validated now this profile by again taking the microarrays of primary tumors of patients who were treated for their metastatic disease with tamoxifen. And what I can show you here is that in that validation set, again, the non-responders were very well predicted by this 81 gene profile. So there is a 14-month difference in predicting the effect of tamoxifen in the ones that have the 81 gene non-responder versus the 81 responder set of these 81 genes. When we took that a little further, and I'll have no time to discuss the details, but if we compare that, or if we combine that 81 profile with the progesterone receptor expressed on the same tumors, you can see there's even a 21-month difference in predicting the time to progression of disease for these patients. So especially this patient group would maybe be well helped if they would not get tamoxifen, but would immediately start aromatase inhibitors as first treatment for their metastatic disease. So this is just to show you that there are profiles in these tumors that are helpful to maybe guide therapy choices. So I hope I showed in my talk that if you look at single genes, you have little information, but these comprehensive sets of microarrays help you to further guide the clinical management of patients and the choice of treatment, and that maybe in some years all patients will have their tumor activity diagnosed on a microarray, and that will help them into what is the best treatment scheme for these patients. And that you really can have the genomics to help you to decide which patient is actually the one that is the one that will benefit from the chemotherapy, if nowadays you would have to treat 100 women to achieve the same. This has also been discussed at the medical oncologist meeting in Istanbul, the European one, last year, where there was a yes-no debating. And I think that the tests that are around right now, 66% said, at least for some of my patients, I would start to use this based on the current data. I think other people may wait until these large clinical trials are completed that I showed you before, where we need to test 6,000 patients. But I think there's also time to readdress the issue whether these high-powered trials are really necessary and feasible to test these, as these are very costly, and I don't think that the healthcare will be able to provide the funding to test all these biological markers in such large clinical trials as they are budgeted with several tens of millions of dollars. So I'd like to acknowledge all the people who work in my group at the Netherlands Cancer Institute, who many have contributed to this work or are working on other projects who actually involve in cancer susceptibility, and to all the people with whom I work on these large clinical trials by implementing the microarray in daily clinical practice that are listed here. Our work originated with a collaboration with Rosetta Informatics in Seattle in the US, and we have been greatly supported by the Netherlands Health Insurance Council, the Dutch Cancer Society, and the European Union in their six framework program. Thank you very much.
think we have time for a question, Jim.
When you're taking the tumor sample for profiling, obviously you get not only the tumor cells, but also the invasive cells as well as peripheral material. So do you have some sense of how much those additional cell types actually confound or maybe even improve the profiling results?
We have no really proof, of course, but we have an idea. And I think for a number of the genes that are expressed in most of these profiles that I discussed, although I didn't show you any detail, we know that maybe some 20-30% is likely to be expressed in the surrounding tissue. And I think there are also indications in particular parts of the surrounding tissue, whether it's lymphocytes or stromal tissue, are really important from mouse models in propagating tumor growth. But we do assess the number of tumor cells that are in the specimen we're looking at, and we require a minimum of 30-50%.
I think we have another question right down here.
This is actually not a scientific one. When you were putting together your panel of 70 genes, did you have to license any gene-related patents from other organizations?
We investigated it to a great extent to see whether there was any licensed gene in there, and so far we are not aware of that.
I think the only time you know is when you start to make money.
I also said so far.
Okay, let me thank all of the speakers this morning, and thank you very much.